What in the name of holy god deus up did we actually get to witness today? This episode was absolutely stunning and mind-blowing. I really do not have words to describe how good this really was. This was totally on a cinematic level. It really reminded me, like especially certain moments of this episode really reminded me of the One Piece Gold movie. The animation, the coloring, the framing, the direction, the special effects, each and every single thing was just perfect. And I know a lot of people are going to complain even today that the pacing is so bad, we have not reached Onigashima so far. But as of the recording of this video, according to this episode, I just don't care. I'm just enjoying my ass off in this particular episode because this was so damn good. Megumi Ishitani for the win. She's just such a talented lady. Hats off to her, bow down to her. She is definitely showing her true caliber here, especially in this particular episode. And obviously the questions or the parallels to episode 957 are also going to be there. For me personally, that episode was more important, so I might say that yeah, that episode was better in a way. But if we are just simply talking about animation, special effects and the direction overall, I am probably going to lean towards episode 982. So hello and welcome to UnderYZ, my name is Soham and thank you so much for joining in. In this episode, we are going to talk about One Piece episode 982 because things are absolutely gorgeous. And I know that I will probably be repeating the words like gorgeous, beautiful and stunning a lot in this video, a lot in this review so far. But I just cannot do anything because this episode just mesmerized me. Let's be real, this episode is probably a huge contender to be anime of the year episode. Like this has to be it, this has to be it. We are eating good, One Piece fans are eating really really good. So essentially this episode mostly shows us how the Torii Gate has been cleared now. The Akazaya 9 get to see the aftermath of the Torii Gate being destroyed, and as a result of it, they are now practically heading towards Onigashima. And as a whole, this is the main essence of this episode, this is the main theme of this episode. And on the other hand, we get to see a part of the Onigashima as well, because the festival has finally begun and we get to see the true side of Queen here. I know that the debate of a manga versus anime is never going to end. The manga obviously has its own perks, and similarly the anime also has its own perks, and that is absolutely on display with the character of Queen here in this particular episode. Because anime Queen is truly the main depiction of the way in which Oda wanted to interpret him or wanted to bring him to life, because the anime has truly made him a character. The entire zoom 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 dance is just stuck into my mind and it's just going on and on and on in a loop. And the way in which he introduced all the various factions of the beast pirates, from gifters to the waiters to the headliners and even the Tobiroppo. I mean, obviously the Tobiroppo was not there, they don't really care about Queen, but still this entire sequence was just so damn good. And another thing which I really enjoyed here is that we actually get to see the beast pirates enjoying here. This is not just a evil organization just for the sake of being an evil organization. Obviously manga readers know how things are going to turn out eventually in the story, but at least for now the beast pirates are not looking like some intellectual bunch of assholes who are just, you know, doing things for the sake of doing things. Rather, they are actually enjoying this party. This is one time of the year where they actually be or get to be themselves. They are drinking, they are having fun, they are talking to each other, they are interacting. It genuinely feels like a real thing. It's not just limited to the Straw Hats themselves. It genuinely feels like a faction here, a faction who is just enjoying themselves one time for the year. And unfortunately, things are not going to end up good for them because there's a huge raid which is about to start very soon. And on that topic, when the Queen dance actually began, this was totally of a cinematic quality. I mean, let's be real, when we saw that presented by Onigashima, we really thought that this was probably a commercial which is coming up, because this was just so damn good. The green and yellowish color lighting and how Scratchman Apu was basically being like a hype man, it's epic, it's literally epic. I never really cared much about Apu in the story so far, but he really shined in this episode. He really really shined in this episode. And what should I even say about Queen? He is truly looking like a character now. He is not just someone who is just there for the sake of being there. He is really looking like a character so far now, especially because of this episode. And once again, I'm just repeating my points here, but truly the animation and the coloring, I mean the coloring is just so damn beautiful. And the panning shot of the crowd or the audience really reminded me of something like MAPPA. Like, it was a little bit of CGI. Again, I'm not some Sakura lad or some animation connoisseur. I'm not going to be able to correctly give you all which animator or which person did which particular shot. But overall, to me, this really looked like something on the level of MAPPA. And this was just overall very well handled. And coming back to the scenes of the Straw Hats, there's some pretty interesting stuff which are going on here, because we get to see Luffy using Red Hawk. And oh my goodness, this was just so damn good. And once again, I don't know if this was intentional or maybe just as a passing whim, but there's a lot of manga references in this episode. I'm not going to talk about it here right now, but this video towards the end is going to have a manga spoiler section. Anime only people have been warned, and once again I'm going to give you all a warning before that section eventually begins, because I need to talk about a couple of different scenes which are shown in this episode which are directly like a correlation to the current manga chapter, which is pretty interesting for me at least. So after the Red Hawk scene, basically the Tori gates have been totally destroyed. The Akazanan sees this, even Law sees it, and he's like, the Straw Hats are just so reckless and so dumb in a way. But the Akazanan and all the samurais are very much hyped up about this thing, and they charge directly into Onigashima. And this was once again a very beautiful scene, accompanied by some very stellar framing. At the same time, we also get to see a shot of none other than Kozuki Oden, who is sort of leading the charge himself, which is obviously in the form of Kinemon, who is leading the charge currently. So yeah, the symbolism once again is pretty good. Now technically, some people might say that this is sort of into the fillerish dimension, but once again, I don't care, because the overall episode was just beautifully handled overall. And after this, we also get to see something very interesting, which is in the form of the Straw Hats interaction. Because this is something which has been sort of a complaint of the post-time skip era of One Piece, how we don't get to see the classical interaction of the Straw Hats crew and how they basically interacted with each other. The character interactions are sort of missing here. I'm not going to deny that, because mostly the post-time skip era has been quite chaotic and there's not really room for that much emotion or that much connection between the Straw Hats every single time. But this episode, on the other hand, showcased that absolutely spot on. I mean, we literally get to see Chopper chilling upon the shoulders of Zoro. Then we get to see the entire banter between Zoro and Sanji about how Marimo is trying to get the booze. Then there was the interaction between Franky and Usopp. And on the topic of Usopp, Usopp, Nami and Chopper congratulating everyone, saying that good work everyone for destroying the Tori gates. And even we get to see Robin pouring sake in the cup of Jinbei. So basically they were trying to make a celebratory toast here after they have successfully defeated the Tori gate obstacles. But in the meantime, while the samurai zoom past them, Luffy actually puts down the cup and he's like, let's not do it right now. Let's do it later on, once we have defeated Kaido, once we have defeated Orochi, once we have defeated Big Mom, we are going to have the biggest banquet, the biggest party that we have ever had. And with this, all of them put down the celebratory cups and they start heading back to Onigashima. This was really well handled, this was really beautiful. Now before we jump into the manga spoiler section, I just want to talk about one particular bit which I found a little hilarious, and that is in relation to Carrot. Now obviously Carrot is not an official Straw Hat, she has been just accompanying them since Whole Cake Island, so it kind of makes sense to not include her in the celebratory toast scene, because this is just a celebratory moment for the Straw Hats after Jinbei has joined them. But even then, what exactly is Carrot doing? Where exactly is she at this particular moment? Is she just hiding inside of Sunny and giving the time to the Straw Hat crews to have their own moment? I don't really think that makes sense. At the same time, Luffy is not someone who is going to disallow someone, especially Carrot for that matter, from joining them in a celebratory toast. He's just not that kind of a character. So it kind of seems like funny, but at the same time, I understand why this decision was done. It was basically to show a moment of the Straw Hats themselves. And next week, we are finally heading towards Onigashima properly. And at the same time, the entire scene about Tobiroppo was also really well handled. The small subtleties here and there were really great. And at the same time, their voice actors are also really good, especially Ulti. I mean, let's be real, we all like the character of Ulti, so there's no point in arguing about that as well. And especially it was funny when she's talking about Kaido and everyone is just freaking out. And lastly, talking about Kaido, we also get to see the scenes about Orochi and Kaido. Orochi just having his fun with the ladies, and Kaido is talking about, or rather finally talking about, the person whom we get to see in the opening of the series, and it is none other than the son of Kaido. For the sake of the anime only people, I'm not going to say the name of this character. We are going to get introduced to this person very soon, so let's just hold our horses till then. Now, we are going to enter some manga spoiler territory, so anime only people have been warned. You can just end the video, you can just click off the video at this moment because we are entering some pretty big manga spoiler territory, so you have been warned. So, this particular shot of the Red Hawk. I mean, let's be real, each and every single one of us who has read chapter 1018 immediately connected this to none other than the sun god Nika. Now, sure, this might be our recency bias, just because we read the chapter recently, we are linking all of these things to an event or an incident which happened in the manga. But even then, the shot position and the way in which Luffy is using Red Hawk and how there's this huge solar thing or fiery thing behind him, it is really reminiscent of the sun. So I would not be surprised if this is actually a reference to the sun god Nika from the manga. I know that this episode was probably produced way before the manga was actually published, but I mean, who knows what exactly is going on behind the scenes. At the same time, when Hyogoro is talking about hope and despair, this is obviously a reference to, once again, sun god Nika in my opinion. How this entity takes the despair of people and turns them into hope. It's once again a reference to how Law is also talking about Luffy, especially when he's teaming up with Kid to take on Big Mom as well. So this is all about One Piece episode 982. What do you guys think about all of these things? Please do let me know your thoughts in the comment section below. So that's it for today, guys. Thank you so much for watching. Please give this video a thumbs up if you like it, share it with your friends, and subscribe to our channel for more.